We G-chat. All right. But that's how you know who's a close personal friend. You don't G-chat with just anybody. So... nope. Fake out. This is more about nightlife when you were a kid. Which is about TV. Okay. Ready? Welcome back. Welcome back. Troll dolls in the 90s. What some grown women are saying about how cute they were and weren't. What happens next? A major break. A journal in the United States now reveals what happened in a telephone conversation between two 11-year-old girls. The speakerphone button that exposed one little girl's raw a cappella singing and the family members who enjoyed it. Dress-up clothes secrets. A box of used clothing found in a former little girl's bedroom. Why she drugged the box so far away from the attic, and the race to find out how she became fake pregnant. From ABC World News headquarters, this is ABC World News Tonight. Good evening, and thanks for tuning in. I'm Donna McKenzie. The subdivision, called Forrester Woods. A friendly block of homes with a powerful swim team. Some 2 miles from the nearest high school. It was Donna McKenzie's 11th birthday. Her and her parents organized a slumber party to celebrate. The only thing Donna McKenzie wanted for her birthday was trolls. So that's exactly what every party guest brought her. But they brought her treasure trolls, the knockoff version of the original Rust Troll doll made by Ace Toys. The distinguishing feature, a jewel for a belly button. Every girl brought an Ace Toys knockoff troll doll except for one little girl, not yet 11. She brought an authentic Rust Troll doll, naked, with rainbow hair. A distended belly with no jewel in its button. It looked expensive. And it was the troll Donna McKenzie had been waiting for. A troll she received from a girl who was in a slightly higher social tier than 11-year-old Donna McKenzie. But the girl attended the slumber party because of their secret connection. They were both named Donna. The connection was secret, but it was also special. But how special? Stay with us. This is a commercial. Donna weren't your average adolescent girls. They had big plans for their neighborhood. They decided to start an amusement park in Donna McKenzie's front yard. They would call it Donna's Wheel World. The S would be possessive plural because there were two of them. And it was both of theirs. Patrons at Donna's Wheel World enjoyed live clown shows, a piñata, and paying customers under 3 years old could participate in a puffy paint peanut hunt, searching high and low for peanuts. And the in the dry Bermuda grass belonging to Donna McKenzie's parents, named Mr. and Mrs. after their parents. Donna McKenzie and Donna invited one additional friend each to become junior partners in the enterprise. Donna chose Beth Lattimore, who brought her long blonde hair and private school education to the table. Donna McKenzie chose Samantha Vijay. Samantha Vijay was chunky, and her family was Sri Lankan. Her family made delicious cookies Donna McKenzie had never eaten before. They were called Kisses, the name possibly inspired by the famous American candy, Hershey's Kisses, shaped similarly. But Samantha Vijay's Kisses were bigger and not made of chocolate. Over the phone, Samantha Vijay said she could never tell Donna McKenzie the recipe because it was secret. Hearing this many times over, Donna McKenzie began to violently hang up on her. She had to know the secret ingredients, and she'd dial back over and over again to find out. Donna McKenzie still remembers her 7-digit phone number and the tune the numbers made in her ear. Once on the phone, Donna McKenzie sang young Samantha Vijay a song, "Whose Bed Have Your Boots Been Under?" made famous by country western superstar Shania Twain. The song was sung in confidentiality, or so Donna McKenzie thought. Mid-song, she heard a group of people laughing, a group of people with Sri Lankan accents. She wasn't just performing for Samantha Vijay, a child prodigy who knew how to use speakerphone technology and secret cookie recipes to push Donna McKenzie to her darkest emotional edges. Samantha Vijay was unable to fulfill her duties as junior partner in Donna's Wheel World. She had other priorities, relatives that needed visiting. She was seen leaving the weekend of the event in a Ford Taurus with her parents, also named Mr. and Mrs., returning to the neighborhood mere hours after Donna's Wheel World had shut its doors. What happened after Donna's wheel world was abandoned by its fourth partner? Was the damage enough to sever the burgeoning entrepreneurial bond shared by the Donnas? Stay with us. Welcome back. I'm Donna McKenzie, reporting. Donna McKenzie and Donna, the two little girls who created the amusement park sensation, Donna's Wheel World, grossing only 700 cents after being open for over 180 minutes, trying their best to recover from the pain and financial turmoil caused by losing junior partner Samantha Vijay. To do this, they had to carve out time to just be little girls. At Donna McKenzie's house on Sandpiper Lane, the girls played with dress-up clothes. Dress-up clothes found in an oversized moving box in the playroom attic. A playroom with a door that had no lock at all. A security the girls had counted on. But Donna and Donna McKenzie were familiar with overcoming obstacles to create new whimsical worlds paying customers could enjoy. They dragged the box all the way to Donna McKenzie's private bedroom. This door had a lock. The clothes inside the box were dresses that formerly belonged to Donna McKenzie's mother, Mrs., who wore them as a teen. In the 1970s, a decade soured by post-Vietnam War unrest, the two Donnas slipped dress-up clothes dresses over their matching Dockers pants outfits and stuffed them with handfuls of other dresses in order to appear pregnant to one another. That's not where the game ended. In the privacy of a locked bedroom, Donna and Donna McKenzie transformed themselves. into unmarried pregnant street hookers. Roles that were performed by assuming the positions of classic hitchhikers, sticking their thumbs out, looking for a ride from anyone who might be driving through Donna McKenzie's room in an imaginary vehicle, of which there were many. Multiple imaginary vehicles nearly struck the girls dead, narrowly missing their bloated, pregnant bellies. When it was time to give birth, Donna and Donna McKenzie took turns playing OBGYN, delivering one another's babies on the side of the imaginary road with nothing more than their bare hands. As the babies were born, they rushed to swaddle them in Aunt Jo's old bridesmaid dress. When they tired of pregnant street hooker, Donna and Donna McKenzie would take off their clothes and take turns playing pornographer. One would operate a mime camera and make shutter noises with her mouth to indicate that a picture had been taken, while the other posed with an oversized stuffed bear. The girls took turns practicing kissing a stand that Donna McKenzie's gyroscope sat on. The gyroscope was a Christmas present purchased by Santa Claus from a Cracker Barrel restaurant and gift store. Donna McKenzie never used her gyroscope and didn't fully understand its function. But that didn't stop her from passionately kissing its little red stand in front of Donna, whose love of horses led her to pursue a career as an equine veterinarian. All right, thanks to Connie and our sister network ESPN for that story. GMA, first thing in the morning, John Muir back in the chair tomorrow. Thanks for watching, and good night.
And Markey, ladies and gentlemen.